This program is brought to you by thepodcastfactory.com.
Canine crew, it's time to just sell the damn thing. Doberman Dan is revealing his contrarian formula for getting a rush of new customers, building your business faster, and making the highest possible profits. Go to justsellthedamnthing.com to get your copy today.
Prepare yourself for the uncensored, nothing held back, no BS reality of how business and life really work. Doberman Dan is off the chain.
JR, I received a pleasant surprise today, and it came from, of all people, but your wife, Rachel, aka Cupcake.
What? What did she say? What?
Yeah.
What the what?
Well, here's what she said. What? She said, so I got my stats sent to me about the podcast, and my inbox is a little full. I'm suffering inbox overwhelm. So I just kind of like, I saw that I got that email, but I hadn't taken a look at the stats. And she is showing me that March numbers are up quite a bit from February. And then she says, according to Libsyn Benchmark, so Libsyn, for anybody who doesn't know, that's the, you tell them what that is. You're the expert. I'll do a crappy job of explaining what Libsyn is.
I think the simplest way to explain Libsyn is where the podcast lives, where the audio lives.
Okay. That is a better explanation than I was going to give. According to Libsyn Benchmarks, she says, your show is doing better than 50% of all other shows.
Ooh.
So, like my little voice in the desert to my little audience, I must have a pretty responsive listenership.
Dude, I can't even imagine after all these years, of course.
That was pretty cool to find out, especially on the day that we're recording new episodes.
You know what? That now that you say that out loud, I think that we need to engineer this because we didn't do it on purpose, but it seems like something we could engineer. Whenever I'm going to talk to a client, we got to give them good news before I get on the phone with them.
Yeah, for sure. That's the right time to do it.
Good, good. Thank you for the tip. But yeah, the show, you have hundreds and hundreds of episodes and people listen to you every week and you haven't ever missed a week. So it's kind of hard not to have a good audience when you show up every week.
Yeah, that's like a secret, isn't it? Just showing up consistently, showing up somewhere and showing up, period, and showing up somewhere and then showing up somewhere consistently for someone.
Yeah.
Sounds simple enough, doesn't it?
And you would think so.
In theory, it sounds simple enough. I guess it is simple, but I've not found it easy to do.
That's a different question though. Simple and easy, two different things. Showing up for 227 weeks is pretty, I mean, that's like, yeah, I'm going to put in my work, rain, sleet, or snow. I'm there 227 weeks without missing. I love it.
Even when I felt like complete doggy doo-doo at times and was on the precipice of quitting everything. And when I say everything, I mean everything literally and still showing up. I celebrated with this month's Doberman Dan letter, that was issue 100. Not that that's like a landmark. It's just 100. So it's an easy, it's an even number. I mean, and it's like, it's 100 issues, man. That's,
wow. Congratulations.
I'm more than 9 years into it. Thanks.
That is crazy.
I spoke on, was it last week? I spoke on a podcast last week, the Hustle and Flowchart podcast with Matt and Joe.
Yeah.
And they were asking about my print newsletter. And they said, yeah, we did a print newsletter for a while. And we lasted 13 issues.
That's it?
Like, they were thinking that was a bad thing. And I said, congratulations, guys. You lasted 7 issues longer than most people who start a print newsletter.
No kidding.
I think Jay Abraham made it 8 months with his, maybe. Like, so he's a biggie in our space.
Yeah.
And I think he lasted 18 months with his print newsletter. And I've seen a ton of people start one and quit. I've seen very few people have longevity more than a couple years. When you go to 5 years, the number gets really small. Go to 10 years or more, it gets really, really small. Like, you know, go to 40 years, Dan Kennedy is like the last man standing in that category.
You know what? I take it for granted because I got introduced to the newsletter thing with you and Ben, and it's like you guys have been doing it for so many years. It's like if you haven't done it this long, then you're not serious in my mind. I don't know if that's bad or not, but that's the way I feel about it. I like to find an old newsletter that has 100 issues and be like, damn, this thing's still going. Must be good.
Yeah. And that's another thing that sounds simple in theory. It's hard to do, man. Like, you know, people are giving you money for a newsletter. They are expecting you to hit it out of the park every month.
There's pressure.
And big time pressure. Like, few people are forgiving when you don't hit it out of the park. It's like, it ain't easy at all. And so, you know, which is the topic I wanted to talk about today. I think that the topic title I sent you over today was Things Not Going As Expected, Do This.
Yes.
And it's ironic. I didn't plan this opener for us to be talking about the 227 episodes of the podcast, the weekly episodes, the 100 issues of my newsletter, the 100th issue of my newsletter I just finished. But so I've been a serial entrepreneur for 3 decades now. I've been a direct response marketer for, I'm coming up on a quarter of a century. So I guess 24 years or something like that. And I start to feel a little entitled, you know, like this stuff should be easier by now. And I get all bummed out and feeling down on myself because lately things just are not going as expected. Like you think I've gotten good at this stuff after doing it almost a quarter of a century. You know, some people say I'm one of the best copywriters in the world. I've never said that. Other people have said it. So you think like just everything I should touch should turn to gold. Just recently, like everything I am touching is crickets. Like hello, hello, hello. Is this thing on? Is it? It's like nothing. You know, everything is crickets. You know, did like a mini launch, if you want to call it, like a week long promotion with a deadline recently via email. Crickets.
What was it for? What was the promotion?
Some copy templates, a course on how to, well, so I was licensing some of my most successful copy with a course showing people how to adapt it and tweak it for their offer. And like crickets, and it sold great the last time I promoted it. Let me see, what else has been tanking? Oh, I know. So I had a client gig all set up for the month of April, like had the whole month blocked out as far as client work. That was it. I was just going to focus on that. And then, you know, things happened with the schedule and they had to delay it. So it was delayed till May, possibly June. So here I felt like all dressed up and nowhere to go. Well, you know, I've been doing this quarter of a century. I'm well known in this space. I'll just send out a quick email saying, hey, all dressed up, nowhere to go. I had April blocked off. You know, I got a spot open. Send it out to my knights list. These are the people who pay to be in my membership and to receive my newsletter. That was the message. Basically, had all of April reserved. It's now open. If you want to book me for a copy gig, click here and this will explain the procedure. Crickets. And I'm like, okay, well, that's like is a blow to a guy's ego who's supposed to be one of the better known, if not one of the most well-known copywriters in this niche. So, all right. So, you know, just maybe not a need. Let me send it out to my big ass generalist.
They thought it was April Fool's.
Maybe so. Maybe that was it because it went out the first part of April.
You're not doing client
something.
Work.
Well, for sure, I'll get something from my big ass list, which is a combination of, I mean, there are people on there who have done business with me. There are people on there who have just opted in the past. There are people who wanted information on my book, but never bought it. So, but I'm thinking there's, you know, there's gotta be some needles in a haystack there. I'll send it out the whole haystack.
Crickets.
Let's see what else.
Too good.
You know, same thing. Like all these things, like nothing is going as expected. I'm getting all bummed out. I even told my wife, like,
I'm quitting.
Quarter century of my life invested in this. You know, I'm famous in my little niche. I mean, famous, that sounds silly saying it, but I'm, you know, I've got a level of celebrity in my particular niche. And I thought, you know, wow. And yet nothing is going as expected. Yeah, maybe this is a sign. Maybe it's time to just exit this particular universe and start some other business.
No.
And then I was reminded of something I recently read in the Bhagavad Gita. It's in chapter 2, verse 47. And it says, you have a right to perform your prescribed duties, but you are not entitled to the fruits of your actions. Never consider yourself to be the cause of the results of your activities, nor be attached to inaction. And so, like, I'd be lying if I told you that I intellectually understood the Bhagavad Gita. And I'm not sure. I mean, don't ask me to explain the spiritual aspect of that or that particular book. I'm a complete rookie in that department. But I think the Bhagavad Gita is not meant to be understood intellectually, nor studied intellectually. I think it's meant to be understood at a deeper level, intuitively. But still, that chapter and verse, it's interesting that, you know, that's what popped into my head when I'm thinking I'm a loser and it's time for me to, like, quit this and do something else. And I find that interesting on several levels. Like, you have a right to perform prescribed duties, but you're not entitled to the fruits of your actions. Never consider yourself to be the cause of the results of your activities. So it's talking about, it gives you four instructions here. When it's talking about work or duties, first it says, do your duty, but don't get all wrapped up with the results. And then it says the fruits of your actions are not for your enjoyment. And then the third thing is, even while you're doing the work or when you've done the work, don't have pride in the doership. And then the fourth thing it says, don't be attached to inaction. That second thing, the fruits of your action are not for your enjoyment, I'm not going to comment about, mostly because I still don't understand it. And so I think it'll take us off on a different tangent we don't want to go down. But I do know something about getting caught up in or getting concerned with the results of your work, just based on my observations. First of all, you got to admit, it's pretty interesting when it says, you know, don't get, you know, hung up on the results. On so many different levels, I've seen that, like, hamstring people, right? So there are so many things outside of your control. And when you start getting all anxious for the results, well, now you're just going to have anxiety when those results aren't happening according to the expectations you had built up in your cranium. And then when you get all anxious about that, then that screws up your ability to do a good job. And I think that's why Sri Krishna said to Arjuna to give up being concerned about the results and just focus on doing a good job. When you're, like, totally unconcerned about the results, you're able to focus just on your efforts, you know, and you can focus on just doing the work. And therefore, in many cases, the results will be even better than before. But in another way, like, getting concerned about the results, which are often outside of your control, you know what is within your control? Is you just doing the work, like we talked about earlier, right? Just showing up and doing the work. You know, it'd be best if you show up somewhere, you know, and show up for someone and do the work, you know, instead of just being broad and showing up anywhere and doing the work. Like, so I show up in places where people understand my skill set and value my skill set, but I show up, Like, that's the key. And every time I've seen somebody get all concerned about the results, like, it totally screws up their head, right? Yeah. Or they have expectations. And when those don't happen, it's like they just implode, right?
Yeah.
Or, you know, expectations, that's another message in the Bhagavad Gita, that renouncing, you know, I prefer the word surrender, but it talks about renouncing. When you've renounced the results, you know, like, you got that Zen thing, you got that Bill Murray thing happening. We talked about a couple weeks ago, right?
Yeah.
It just doesn't matter. But when you start getting all anxious for the results, or you build up this how it's going to be in your mind, and now all of a sudden people can feel that you're broadcasting something. And ironically, you're broadcasting a desire, but that's not the ironic part. You're broadcasting a desire. The ironic part is that's repelling, especially when you're broadcasting a desire like, I got to get this client. They run from you when you're anxious about results like that. So I found some practical, pragmatic, actionable business advice in the Bhagavad Gita. Or the acronym I've heard for this is NATO, NATO, not attached to outcome, right? You just show up and do the work. The last thing I'll comment on in that chapter and verse is, don't be attached to inaction either. So, you know, Sri Krishna's talking about just do the work. Quit worrying about all this stuff and quit worrying about results. Just do the work. But don't be attached to inaction either, which is like exactly where my mind was going when everything was sucking out loud. Well, it's still, to be honest with you, it still kind of sucks. It hasn't turned around yet, but I'm still showing up and doing the work. So, you know, Krishna's explaining to Arjuna, it's totally not cool if, because you're attached to these results, you start thinking of your work as this horrible, laborious, burdensome thing, and you're like, screw it, and just, you know, resort to inaction. So in that case, you're now attached to inaction, and that's not the solution either. You know, I think Krishna is just saying, hey man, just show up and do the work, right? That's my take on it, at least.
Man, I can't believe we started the episode like that and we hadn't talked about it. They're going to think we planned this stuff.
No,
Dan.
I just wanted to brag about my podcast.
Yeah, man. So, Dan, what do you have coming up for us next time?
Oh, I'm going to talk about the door to freedom.
The door to freedom. I cannot wait. Off the Chain Crew will be back in your earbuds next time. Thank you for tuning in. Canine Crew, before you run off, I want to remind you, Doberman Dan has set up an off-the-chain hotline. Call in, tell us you love us. It's even better if you tell us you hate us. It doesn't matter what you say. All you have to do is call in, leave a message. The number is 321-424-6043. Again, off-the-chain hotline, 321-424-6043.
This is the PodcastFactory.com.